So I thought before we start tonight, talk a little bit about process and kind of where we're headed from here in terms of the budget activity so that everyone is kind of following the process. Tonight's agenda is to go through the school budget, and its format is really a review for the Finance Committee. Superintendent, I believe, will be making a presentation. We sent some questions in advance to the superintendent, and he supplied answers to those as well, so we'll talk through those questions. And tonight's mission is for the Finance Committee to get comfortable and or have any questions that remain with that. The next activity will be next week, so that'll be on the 24th. The Finance Committee will be voting all of the line items for the budget that will then get submitted to town meeting for approval. So at that time, we'll be looking at all of the requests that have been made. We'll have had a chance, hopefully, to review all the information, ask any further questions, and then next week, we plan to take the vote by line item in terms of what's going on. That information then will get packaged to go to town meeting. There'll be some messages that go with it. The town manager clearly has some messages. The Board of Selectmen, the chair of the board, will have something that goes into the warrant and presentation of town meeting, as will FinCom, or the chair of FinCom usually as well. And then town meeting is now April 25th, approximately. So that's kind of where we are in terms of process and how things are going to happen. So tonight's agenda really is school budget. So I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Daugherty, please.
Do you want
to? Yeah. So I think if you guys don't mind, Finance Committee is going to come over to this side. We don't mean anything bad by it. We can see.
Oh, that's fine.
Yeah, no, please.
Thank you.
Seeing it for the fourth time, you might get a little tired.
And they're warmed up for it.
Thanks, guys.
Okay. Thank you for giving us the opportunity this evening. A few weeks ago, we sent you two budget documents, so I just want to explain both of them. One is the budget document that we have been putting together for the last several years, which doesn't just talk numbers, it also gives a complete picture of our entire school district. And we feel that every year, it's important for us to put some words to the numbers. So that's why we feel that budget document is important to the entire community. You also received the actual Munis budget document, which are the numbers, without any words or explanations. And I know that there's been requests in the past for both. So this year, that's why we sent you both documents. You'll notice that when you look at the bottom line numbers of every category of the Munis budget, it matches what's in the other document. So. You know, whatever your learning style is, feel free to use either document. So what we want to first talk about is an overview, and then we'll drill down into the numbers. Martha is also going to spend a little bit of time talking about revolving accounts tonight, because I know that was one of the questions that was asked. So we'll be spending some time on that. We'll also be spending a little bit of time on the per pupil piece, because that's come up a few times. And I know there's been some questions about, well, what if you remove transportation? Would that affect the per pupil and where you compare to other communities? So we're gonna talk a lot about all those things tonight, as well as the numbers. The first, though, I want to talk about how do we develop this budget. We develop the budget through our goals, and we have five district goals, as you can see here. Each of those goals has a series of action steps behind it. And really, this is how we run our business, how we run our school district, and how we move forward as a school district towards where we want to go, our vision. Here is kind of like a one-slide snapshot of some of the different actions that we are doing under these goals. And over the last couple of years, we have been using these same five goals because we've got a lot of work going on in curriculum and instruction and social-emotional learning and meeting the needs of the whole child. And those are all very important goals as we move forward. We're transitioning right now. Over the last few years, we're not the only district. All districts in Massachusetts are transitioning in curriculum and assessment. So those are some of the things that have been happening as well, and those are captured in these five goals. So I want to talk a little bit about first the Chapter 70 piece. As you know, we do get an amount of Chapter 70 funding each year. Over the last couple of years, that number has been just a small increase, which is what's called the hold harmless amount. I believe right now in the proposed state budget for next year, I believe it's $20 a student. And really what's happened over the last couple of years is we've reached our maximum number and with the Chapter 70 funding formula, which is why our increase is in Chapter 70 funding, which is the state funding that is used to help fund our educational budget here in the town. That number hasn't gone up that much because we've reached our foundation level. There was a commission that the legislature had put together to look at this formula, because the formula was developed in 1993. And if you think of what's happened in education now and what was in education in 1993, a lot has changed. Technology really didn't exist in 1993. Special education costs were different, healthcare costs were different. Support for more diverse learning student populations of ELL and economically disadvantaged wasn't captured adequately in the 1993 formula. So in October 30th, the report came out that talked about all of the things that were needed to be changed in the formula. It would really, to fully fund the formula, would cost an additional $1 billion. Now, obviously, the state doesn't have an additional $1 billion. So what happened several years ago when they increased funding in the Chapter 70 is they did it over several years. The current, the proposed budget for next year currently does not have any of the recommendations of the Chapter 70 Commission. However, there's been a strong push by the legislature to do something. So it's not going to mean a lot of additional funding for Reading, but it's something to keep our eye on over the next several years. If they start changing the formula and fully funding Chapter 70, what the impact will that be on for Reading? So now a little bit about the per pupil spending, because we always talk a lot about that. The per pupil spending is something that is calculated by all school districts in Massachusetts each year. Martha does the end of the year report, which goes to the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education. And really it is, the end of the year report is all of the revenues and expenditures that are received or made by the district directly or indirectly. So every district has to do the same thing with the same categories. And we'll talk a little bit more detail about that in a second. And so by looking at the per pupil across different districts, particularly your comparable school districts, it helps you get a better understanding where you're putting your funding in each of the categories to support the educational needs of the student in the district. So here are the functional categories that DESE requires us to use when the end of the year report is being submitted. And you can see that they're in a range of areas. Our budget book with the narrative mirrors the DESE categories for that reason. So that when we're budgeting, it's a seamless transition to the reporting mechanism that DESE requires. So these are all the different categories. Some are pretty self-explanatory. You'll notice that we do have to capture some things that aren't necessarily directly in our budget, but maybe in the town budget or other budgets, like in retirement, health insurance, things like that, debt service, things like that as well. You've seen this graph before, but this is showing how the per pupil expenditure has changed with state in comparison to Reading over the last several years. I think the important thing to note from this chart is that in FY06, the difference was at its narrowest, and as you can see, as time has gone on, that gap has widened over time, and it really is a factor of a couple things. One is the Chapter 70 funding formula does play into this, because those revenues are captured into it, and it's also the amount of funding that the town is able to afford is calculated in this as well. The ranking, as you can see, the gap has gotten wider, the ranking has gone down, and over the last several fiscal years, we've seen that dip. I think what's important is not where we rank, it's that the rank continues to go downward. And when you're trying to provide, you know, services for schools and for students, when you don't have that same sustainable amount of funding each year, that's when you start losing your competitive edge with other school communities. And I think that's more the important point, not where we're ranked, but the fact that it's not where we just keep going in the downward trend instead of staying at a sustainable level. What we've started doing, we had for a long time, the school department had their comparable communities, the town had their comparable communities, so we've decided that we're putting them all together now so that we can start making more, take more of a look at how we compare with the per pupils. So you can see this is over the last five fiscal years that DESE has captured the per pupil expenditure. The FY15 should be out within the next few months, because it takes a while for every school district to submit their end of the year reports, which is why it lags behind by a year plus. So you can see that Reading, in right now, out of the 27 communities, we are ranked we're ranked out of the 27 comparable communities at 27. The percent change is a little bit better. The percent change from FY10 to FY14, we're ranked 23rd. So you can see that the difference, with the average, is we're about $2,000 below the average of the comparable communities, which is about a 15% difference. When you're also looking at per pupil, one of the questions that's come up several times is, well, is it always the same from community to community? And one of the things that people always ask about is transportation. And yes, it is true that Reading has less transportation, regular day transportation, than a lot of other communities, because geographically we're a little bit smaller and we have neighborhood schools, which is very favorable to having less transportation, the way that the regulations are set up. So what we did is we took a look at, what if we took transportation out of the equation? DESE has a tool that allows us to do that. So what we want to show you, and I know this is kind of small, but the one on the left is what you saw earlier, with all of the comparable communities. The one on the right shows you if we took the transportation out. So the one on the left, with transportation, we're ranked 29th out of 30 of the 30 comparable communities that you see here. When you take out the transportation, Reading is now 25th. We spend $255 on transportation. I believe the average is, let me go back, the average is $647. The state average per pupil for transportation. So again, we're just trying to put things into context. You take out transportation, which seems to be a difference between communities, and our per pupil still is at the lower end, 25 out of 30.
So John, so did they have this level of detail on the website? On the
DESE website? It's the Edwin tool.
It's the Edwin analytical tool. So
yeah.
The stuff on the left in the blue, absolutely, is out on the DESE website.
Yeah.
But to drill down and do more analytics, you have to have access to their.
Yeah, it's on their portal, which we have access to. But we're allowed to do it for any of the categories that you saw earlier. So if we want to take out technology, say. We could see, okay, what do we rank if we take out our technology spending, those types of things. Here's a graphic that shows the same thing you saw, only in bar graph form. Reading, you could see, is here when you take out the transportation. And when you look at it with the transportation, we are 29th out of 30. So now going into the proposed the school committee budget for next year, here is really the details of the budget. This is all in the budget book that you have. And it breaks it down, as you can see, by the non-accommodated costs, which are your salary, compensation, materials, supplies, equipment, our offsets, things like that, and the accommodated costs, which are, on the school side is special education, circuit breaker. Now, as you know, utility and energies was moved out after the vote in town meeting to a core facility budget. When you include all of that, the budget now is a for projected for FY17 is $40,847,666. One of the things that's important to note in this budget is that when the finance committee, when we had the financial forum in October, the recommended was $40,697,665. There is a difference of $150,000, and that $150,000 above and beyond the FinCom guidance is for the first year of a 3-year of implementation of science curriculum. As you also probably know, there is an article in the April town meeting to have that for FY16, which we would be prepared to purchase that material in FY16 for next year if that vote was favorable at town meeting. So either way, we would be prepared to do that, whether it be in this fiscal year or the next fiscal year. We are preparing for that, yes.
What is your preference, whether that article be approved at town meeting or that it be approved for FY16?
The advantage of doing it in this fiscal year is the materials are all purchased, and we could begin the training in the summer. So that is an advantage. We have already, just so you know, and I'm going to go in more detail with the science later, we started piloting several of these units this year. So we do have several grades throughout the 5 elementary schools that have started piloting this.
John, I know it's been coming. Can I ask a question, Mark?
Sure.
you go back to that. I've just been thinking about that on the slide, the per pupil.
Which one?
The one that you pulled the busing out.
Yep, this one.
So what one of the things that I've been thinking about is I'd be interested, and I don't know whether Martha, we can find out what other towns are spending for health care, because I think we're spending less than a lot of other towns, which makes our per pupil lower as a result, correct?
No, I think we're spending more. Oh, no, maybe employees.
It is a little less.
Yeah. So we can do that, I think.
I will look at what
we can do.
That.
As we're having discussion.
I don't know if it's health, maybe benefits in general.
It might
which
be
may not,
benefits.
Yeah.
As we're having discussions, you know, over the next few months, I'd like to know.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good question.
John, back to the budget request, the 40,697 versus the 48,47.
Yep.
So the warrant article exists for the 150K. Let's assume that town meeting decides that yes,
yep,
they're in favor of that. The current budget, as submitted by the town manager for the balanced budget, is the 46,97.
Correct. Correct.
So, yes, to make sure I'm understanding, from your perspective, if the 150 was approved by town meeting, then the 46,97 is, I don't know what the right word is here, appropriate, sufficient, correct. I'm not sure what the right word to use. That's the number that would be proposed if the 150 goes through?
If the 150 is approved for FY16,
right,
and the town manager's budget was approved for FY17, that would be fine.
Okay. And then as it relates to FY18 and 19, there's still another $300,000 of this expense. That would have to be factored into those budgets.
To 18 and 19.
18 and
19. That is correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Two quick questions. Revenue offsets, what is that?
We're going to go into great detail on revenue offsets a little bit. It's the different revolving accounts,
yep,
that help offset the budget.
And then energy utilities, why isn't it carried over to the other policy?
Because now we've moved those budget items into a town core budget, which is the town facilities and school facilities.
I just have a question from basic. Follow up on Mark's comment. So you were proposing potentially the 150 in FY16. How out of free cash? How would you
No, there was an article, was it five?
Yeah, I'm going to answer. One of the articles at town meeting was mid-year budget adjustments. You've seen a draft last week. We're doing a lot of different moving around, and the net use of free cash is now zero, technically, because we have surpluses. If it doesn't snow between now and Wednesday, I'm sure I'll regret saying that.
So, would that go into the base for FY 17?
If we know.
Wishful thinking.
Can we get 60? Can I ask one more question?
Sure.
So you need to pre-buy the materials, or you'd like to pre-buy the materials for this curriculum adjustment, or this curriculum update, excuse me. But you wouldn't need to do that in fiscal 17?
No, the 150,000 is to purchase materials.
Right, but then you need them for, like you were saying, it would be in 18 and 19, but would you still need that 150 to buy the materials for fiscal 18?
No,
kind of similar situation where we're going for 12.
So the difference is that if it's approved for FY 16, we would have to purchase them before June 30th.
Okay.
If it's approved for FY 17, we would be purchasing probably on July 2nd.
Gotcha.
So we'd still have them for the start of the school year.
Gotcha.
So when we were developing the FY 17 budget, the priorities that we focused on was continuing to implement the frameworks, Massachusetts curriculum frameworks, including Science Now, which the DESE Board of Education approved in January, making sure that we continue to build the capacity of our staff, making sure we continue to address the social, emotional, and academic needs of our students, maintaining class sizes, appropriate class sizes, recommended class sizes in grades K to 2, which is the 18 to 22 range, preserving the middle school model, making sure we continue to implement our behavioral health initiatives, making sure our facilities stay clean and well maintained, and also maintaining our technology infrastructure. Those were the priorities as we were developing the FY 17 budget. You notice there are not additional things because the resources wouldn't allow us to do that. The drivers for the FY 17 budget really are all of our contractual obligations, whether it be salary based or for goods and services. So our collective bargaining agreement salary increases, non-union salary increases. We also had to go out to bid for special education transportation for next year. That contract is up, as well as our regular day mandatory bus transportation. That contract is up. So we are anticipating increases. We've had two favorable contracts, and I think they've both been five-year contracts once they were rolled over. So those contracts are now coming to an end. So we had to go out to bid on both of those. We did have to make some additions to the FY 17 budget. Based on need. So one of the things that we did in FY 16 to absorb reductions to avoid personnel cuts is we reduced our per pupil building funding. I don't know if you remember that from last year's presentation, but we said that that was only a one-year stopgap solution because we were on a purchasing cycle that allowed us to do it for 1 year because we do a lot of pre-purchasing in the next several months. Leading into the next fiscal year. So we had to restore that back to the original FY 15 level. So we have that increase. As you remember last year, we had a bubble at Barrows, and currently we have a bubble at Barrows in kindergarten. We're going to need to increase, because that group will now be in first grade, so we'll have to add a teacher. Because we had a half a teacher in kindergarten, an extra half a teacher in kindergarten at Barrows, we only need an additional half teacher, because that position combined with another half a position will give us a full FTE. So we'll now have four teachers at grade one at Barrows for next year. We also restored regular education paraeducator hours at each of the elementary schools. When we made this reduction last year, it was primarily in the offices that those hours were cut. We realized very quickly that was not a sustainable model. If you've ever been to an elementary school main office, it's very, very busy. and we have one person, the secretary, that was this at the beginning of this year that was had to deal with all of the phone calls and issues and everything else that go on. So we are restoring the regular education paraeducator hours, a partial restoration for the office in this budget. And we needed a, we have a, the student support program at Killam. We needed to add a social worker for that program. It's the only program, SSP program in the district that does not have its own dedicated social worker. Killam is our biggest elementary school. It always goes back and forth with Joshua Eaton, but right now it is our biggest elementary school. And we have one school psychologist for the entire student population. When you add this program, that's we just don't have the resources to address the needs of the whole population as well as this program. So that social worker is the reason why that had to be added.
SSP program, is that part of special education? Or?
It is a special education program, yes.
Dr. Zardy, would you mind just giving the folks a little idea about what the SSP program is?
So the student support program are for students that have individualized education programs, plans. They're special education students that have a social emotional disability and do require additional counseling services to address anxiety and coping skills, things like that, so that they can go in the classroom and access the curriculum like all the other students. We have a program also at Coolidge, and we have a program at the high school. So as the students progress through the years, they go to those programs if they need those services. So to give a snapshot of the impact that the different budgets have. So this is the adopted FY16 budget. So this is the budget we're currently in. This is the FinCom recommended guides for FY17. The increase is a 3.25% increase. And when you add the 150,000, it's a 3.5% increase. If you take everything that we're doing this year and move it forward next year with the same contractual increases and other increases that are known in special education, and you put in an appropriate increase for bus transportation, you really need a 4.6% increase in the budget. So that's how we're at the point where we had to make the reductions that we're making this year, is that because of the other increases, we're forced to make reductions in other areas. We had similar situations over the last few years. I'm going to show you a chart later on to show you how we've tried to avoid personnel cuts over the last few fiscal years. This year, for next year, we obviously couldn't. So in FY15, we reduced our level service by 285,000, FY16 by 849,000, and FY17, the reduction is 658,000. I'll talk a little more about that in a bit. As you can see also, these are the budget increases, or in one year, a decrease over the last several fiscal years. The average increase over the last five fiscal years, not including the FY17 proposed one, is a 2.64% increase. And as the town manager has said in, I know, his presentations as well, it's very difficult to maintain the level of services that we have in our schools when you have a 2.64% average increase. So now drilling down and taking a look at where the increases are in next year's budget, or decreases. So the first category, salary and other compensations, this is what I was talking about earlier. You have a combination of a couple of things here. You have your contractual increases for salary, and for both contract and for non-union, but this is where the bulk of our reductions are going to be in next year's budget, which is 5.9 teachers, one paraeducator, 0.4 speech and language. Also in this category is the social worker I mentioned earlier. And it, just as a note, last year we made some reductions in the substitute teacher line items in this budget. We are not restoring those in this budget. It seems that the reductions that we made in the the changes that we made in our practices are working at this point. Under contractual services, which is a variety of areas, which include your labor councils and any other contracts that that we go out to bid for. So we do have some increases for things like labor council. The cleaning of the buildings is still, for the schools, is still under the school department, so we're going out to bid for a new cleaning services contract, and our bus transportation. So we've budgeted anticipated increases in those areas. We did have some reductions that we made to special education, professional development, and some curriculum services. So we have a slight increase in this category, $5,000.
Dr. Dorn, I think on transportation, I think the discussion when you presented school committee, when people think transportation, they're thinking gas, and with gas prices down, but there's more restrictions now on, you know, adults on a bus and so on. Is that what's driving the cost, anticipated cost up for transportation?
The increase, well, you also have labor costs, because over 5 years ago, the bus drivers were making less than they are now. But also, what has happened is, I believe, with the new healthcare, well, it's not new anymore, the healthcare law, they've had to pick up more healthcare costs for the employees that are bus drivers. So I think the increases that we're seeing are also contributing to that. Because that's when we haven't gone, the bids aren't in yet for the regular day, but the special education bids, that's what we were hearing when we were, we're part of a collaborative that negotiates out the special ed transportation. And that's what we were hearing, is it's the healthcare costs that are driving, that were driving that contract.
Can I
interject?
Yeah. So just because you mentioned gas prices, our current contract doesn't have any escalation. It's a fixed cost per bus, per day, per route, and field trips and things like that. So there's no escalation for gas.
Yeah.
So if gas goes up, then the vendor loses money,
right,
if you will.
Right.
I just wanted to clarify that.
Can I take you back one side? I apologize for a series of slides. On the additions to the budget, you're restoring some of the regular education paraeducators to 17.5 hours per week per school, so that when we look at the regular ed budget, and it talks about a reduction of one paraeducator, that's net after the increase?
No, that's a different position. That is the library aide at the high school.
Okay.
I'm going to go in more detail on the reductions
okay.
later.
Thanks.
Here we go. Okay. So other expenses is another category. We do have some increases from contracted services for professional development, some increases in network hardware. We did see some reductions for software licensing and reimbursement in special education for parent transportation. Again, this increase in this category is about $6,000. Tuition and transportation for special education is its own category. We're seeing increases for out-of-district placement costs, which is about a 3%, I think, we budgeted increase, and for transportation costs, which I believe it's about a 4 or 5% increase. So that's why you see the $165,000 increase there. And then the grant and revenue offsets is a decrease in what we did in these areas, and we're going to talk in a little bit more detail about the revolving accounts a little bit later, is we did increase our offsets in athletics and extracurricular in the FY17 budget, and also for a special education tuition rise, full day kindergarten, extended day. So we'll go into more detail on those later. And we did decrease the in-district special education tuition, and if you remember from last year, we did a one-year increase in that revolving account to offset the decrease in circuit breaker, because we had a one-year decrease in circuit breaker. So rather than cut positions, we increased our revolving account for 1 year in the special ed tuition budget. But then this year we decreased it again because our circuit breaker went up a little bit. So when you break it down by cost center, there are five cost centers in our budget. The administration, which is the smallest cost center, is about a 4% increase. Regular day, because of most of the reductions in that, are in that category, that cost center is a 1.9% increase. Special education, which is a combination of the decrease in the offset, which will cause to increase, and the tuition increases and transportation increases, is a 7.7% increase. Facilities, because now we've moved the core out, the building piece of the facilities out, is a decrease of 1.9%, and then district-wide programs is a slight increase. So that's where the 3.5% increase comes from. The $150,000 is in regular day. And then when you look at it by category, breaking it down by salaries, you can see that the increases. The supplies and materials, that the biggest thing, the reason why it's 31.8% increase is two major reasons. One is the $150,000 for sciences in there, and the increase in per pupil that I mentioned earlier back to the buildings, restoring it back to the FY15 levels is in that line item. So that's why you see such a large increase in that category. And then when you break it down by cost center, the regular day where most of your classroom costs are is at 61%. The next largest is special education, district-wide programs, school facilities, and administration make up the last pieces of the pie. So here are the reductions. I'm going to go into these in a little bit more detail. Starting first with two elementary teachers, and we're still taking a look at anticipated enrollments for next year. We're taking a look at our kindergarten enrollments, but there will be a reduction of two elementary teachers, which will be in grades 3 through 5, and those will bring the class sizes in those two schools where they're occurring to no more than 25 students in a class. In regular day, also we have a cut of 3.4 high school teachers. What we're doing right now is we're taking a look at what students are signing up for their classes for next year for high school. So those cuts are twofold. The first 2.0 of the 3.4 is we're eliminating the advisory program at the freshman level. We had different teachers in different departments have one or two courses in their teaching schedule. Not every teacher, but in their teaching schedule, some teachers taught what was called advisory, which was for freshman students. It was kind of an introductory program to help transition students into their freshman year of high school. It focused on good study habits and financial literacy and some other skills that students need. So that's two of the positions. The other 1.4 are going to be reduced through the low course enrollments, low enrollments in some courses. And again, we don't know where those areas yet. So those will be across different departments. We also are cutting in that 3.4, and I'm going to connect it to the next one, the high school stipend. So we are cutting a department chair at the high school, and we're going to be actually merging two departments together as well for some savings. It's actually two things happen when you cut a department chair. There is the stipend cut, and then there's also a cut on paper of a 0.4 position in funding. Because a department head has a 0.6 teaching load, and 0.4 of their FTE is for department head duties. So there'll be a cut of 0.4, which is part of the 3.4 cut above. So the 0.4 of the 3.4 is that cut that's connected to the department chair cut. We're going to be cutting at the middle school. There's a 0.5 reading specialist position, What this will do is there will be one reading teacher at each of the two middle schools, which is consistent across the district. Every school has, K through 8 has a, with this reduction, we'll have a one reading specialist. The high school regular education paraeducator is the library aide at the high school. This was a 35-hour position, which is a $23,000 reduction. The biggest impact here is really the after-school library hours is going to be impacted because this person started later in the day and covered the library until, I believe it was 3 o'clock, 3:30. The PTO has agreed to fund that after-school time. This is something that's also done at the middle school level. So that's the impact there. Point four, speech and language, is really a restructuring of our speech and language schedules to address that reduction. It will not be a reduction in services. We also are reducing an anticipated out-of-district placement. When we develop our budget each year, we analyze potential students that may, based on what is going on in their learning plans, that may have to go out for out-of-district placement, and we budget an appropriate number of those students with transportation. What we are doing is we are reducing one of those anticipated by one. We feel it is a risk, but we feel also that this is something that we can take a look at as the year goes on. And if it is a situation where we are running into some budgetary trouble, we can come back and talk to you, the Finance Committee, at town meeting about it. And then we made a variety of miscellaneous reductions across the board, $2,000 here, $3,000 there. Again, the whole purpose of reductions from that are non-personnel was to limit the amount of personnel reductions that we were having. And then the other pieces are the revolving accounts. So we increased the offset of some of these revolving accounts based on several factors, which Martha will go into more detail with those in a little bit. So the extended day one, what we did, and we did our research, we did our homework to make sure that this was an appropriate use of the revolving funds, is extended day is after school for 3 hours a day and 1 hour before school. But we've never charged the cleaning of those areas that they use to the budget. So we are now charging to each elementary school 1 hour per day during the time that the day is there, which is the entire school year, for the cleaning piece of the spaces that are used by extended day. So by doing that, we actually save close to two teaching positions, increasing the offset from extended day. You remember in the FY16 budget, we started charging extended day for the utility space associated with the use of the building. Full day kindergarten, we increased the offset slightly, $30,000 again, because we are having a healthy enrollment in full day kindergarten. We felt that we could do this. Special education tuition, a slight increase in the offset. Athletics, a slight increase. We did, if you remember last year in the FY16 budget, this year's budget, user fees, we increased, which we felt we could do that. But Martha's going to show you the forecast on that. And extracurricular, the same as well. So, again, by increasing the revolving accounts, it allowed us to minimize the impact of personnel cuts, which could have been worse. Another question that came up, I know I did present this at the financial forum in January, is we do have our operating budget, we do have our revolving fund piece. There is a lot more funding that it takes to operate the school department budget. So in addition to the $40 million for the budget guidance, and the 150, which we already talked about, there are revolving fund offsets of a little over $2 million. The circuit breaker, which is the amount that we receive from the state for reimbursement of any student that reaches a threshold cost of, I believe, $38,000, or maybe it's 40. Maybe it's $40,000 now. We get 75% reimbursement. Between 70 and 75% reimbursement of those costs, it's mostly students that are in out-of-district placement. So that amount we get from funding each year. And then grant awards, which include our federal IDA grant, Title I, Title IIA, a little bit of the school transformation grant that we received. So it really is a $46 million budget when you put all of the different funding mechanisms together. In addition, we have all of these things like donations, which the school committee last year approved $160,000 in donations that went to different programs and activities in our schools, and our PTO budgets, which conservatively is about $240,000. So there's a lot of other funding that's used to operate our schools well above and beyond. And user fees for athletics, user fees for buses, those were included in the revolving fund offsets. Kindergarten, full day kindergarten tuition is included in revolving fund offsets, those types of things. So I'm going to have to talk a little bit about the special revenue funds. I don't know if you want me to stop here and take questions.
See if there are any members with questions so far. Any other questions in the audience?
I just have one clarification. This is actually about the cleaning, because I did have a question about if the cleaning is being increased on page 8, you're outsourcing it, but you're taking some of the cleaning from the...
No, the cleaning that's in the content that I was talking about, the outsourcing, that's the high school and for Coolidge. We have one shift at Coolidge and one in pretty much all of our high school, except for we have three custodians. That's a cleaning contract for those two buildings. What we're talking about are five elementary schools where extended day happens.
So the cleaning increase is where there's no extended day.
Correct.
So some of the programs that you run out of the high school, such as renting out the building, things like that, wouldn't that those also be revolving funds that you could then take some of those?
That's part of this. Revolving fund offsets, I believe it's $100,000.
$200,000.
So a portion of that revolving funds that then would just involve high school, correct? Am I getting that correct?
I'm sorry?
Do you have revolving funds that are just unrestricted to the high school?
No.
The revolving funds that you're speaking about now is the use of school property, which when someone is going to rent our facilities, if they require a custodian, they're billed back hour for hour, and so it's somewhat of a wash because we're generating revenue for the expense of the custodian. But we do, there's also a small nominal amount that wear and tear in the building and that sort of thing, and that's what we're taking the offset to use the school property for.
And then the other thing you should realize, when town meeting voted in November to go to the core, that use of school properties is now split with the town, that offset.
I have one other question, but I don't know if this has to do with the finance question about the science curriculum. And I don't know if, in fact, Common Core gets on the ballot in the fall, does that then affect the curriculum that comes out of the state at all? That
the science curriculum that we're referring to is not Common Core, it's the next generation science standards.
So it'll have nothing to do with
anything
that comes
it.
From the state. Okay.
No.
That's what just, okay.
The department. The Board of Education approved those in January. They're not connected to the literacy and mathematics frameworks.
Okay, so totally separate. That's just what you know.
Yeah.
Okay.
John, any questions?
No.
Oh, I'm sorry. Any other questions, Mark?
Yes.
You just have that people sign in somewhere that's
assigned.
Great. So please, if everyone could sign in, just make sure we know that you were here. Appreciate that. Thank you.
Dr. John, how old is our science curriculum?
When I began teaching in 1987, we were really happy because we just bought new textbooks. At the middle school level, those textbooks are still being used today. that's at the middle school. At the elementary level, we've been using kits called STC kits for years. It's probably about 20 plus years. We replace the consumables every year. But the kit itself, the curriculum that we've been using for probably 20-plus years. This is twofold. We're going to a program that's much more robust. It's aligned to the new standards. It integrates literacy and math very nicely, which is something that you want. And the students and the teachers absolutely love the NOADAM science curriculum. Heard very positive things about the pilots that we've been doing in the different classrooms.
Okay, roll on.
So we're going to talk a little bit about our special revenue funds. So, and it's in the budget book. It's figure 113 on page 118 in the budget book. But when I think, I tried to delineate the revolving funds into three categories, if you will. So the first category, there are the revolving funds on the far left. School lunch programs, school transportation, guidance revolving. Those are ones that we typically don't take an offset to. We charge expenses directly to it. So the school transportation is a good example where its revenue is user fee based. So if a child wants to take the bus, they're non-mandated. They live on the route. They attend school grades 7 through 12. We provide a bus. It's a bus with a fee. And we charge the bills that we get from our bus company directly to this revolving fund until the balance gets to zero, and then it starts hitting the operating budget. So this is a revolving fund that we don't take an offset to, we charge directly to it. The school lunch program is self-sustaining. All of the staff are charged directly to that revolving fund. It is allowed to roll forward 3 months worth of operating costs. So when you look at the ending balance as of June 30th, 2015, the ending balance is 3 months worth of operating expense and any money that you may have left on your child's account. So about $60,000 of that ending balance is money that if we started school this year and said we're not doing any more food service, we'd have to refund that $60,000. The guidance revolving fund, some of these are much smaller balances, so I don't necessarily want to go through every single one of them unless you have a particular question about the first column. The other ones are pretty small lost books. If you lose a book, we ask you to pay for it.
Yeah. Right, so you're saying that first column, any costs associated with any of those programs wouldn't really be included in that, what, $46 million? Was that what you just showed us?
Yeah, it's not part of that $2
million right.
that are offsets.
So, yeah, the costs.
And any part that's in our operating budget are things that we will pay for from our operating budget. So our transportation line in our operating budget is what we need to fund the buses that we would have to pay for versus
that one.
Yeah. Okay. The next category is I kind of lumped all of our donation accounts. So each school has a dedicated donation fund. And a lot of these gifts are directed. So if we get a donation from the Parker PTO, typically it's directed towards technology, or it's directed towards playground upgrades, or elementary, any library needs, if you will. So a lot of the gifts that the school committee accept in this category are directed. So the balances that are ending, the ending balances in these accounts, is just a timing difference from spending it versus they haven't placed the order yet. The other thing that goes in the donation accounts, you see these bins at our schools, at every school for textiles. The revenue that we get from that goes into each school's donation account. So sometimes they're accumulating revenue and they'll figure out what they want to spend it on. And this is at the discretion of the building principal when it comes to these funds. And then the last category there on the right, these are the funds that we use for offsets. So by law, we're allowed to generate revenue from specific sources, and then spend the money on these specific sources. So when we generate revenue from user fees that go into athletics, we have to spend the money on athletics. And so each of the revolving funds has an offset. And I'll go a little further in here. Oops. Am I not doing this right?
What are you doing?
Okay. Move it forward. Okay. All right, so here's the first category that I talked about, the school lunch program. And this chart, so I've segmented the chart into three groups so that we can look at it separately. The school lunch program is about 60% of this, the $594,000 ending balance.
And as I mentioned earlier, about $60,000 of that $390,000 is money that's still left on your child's NutriKids account. The other ending balances are pretty reasonable. I don't know if anyone has any questions on these. Do you want me just to keep going?
Just a quick one.
Sure.
So what scenarios does expenses increase over the revenues?
I'm sorry, say it one time.
In what instances, like there are a couple of instances where the expenses are higher than the revenues. Why is that?
I would have to look specifically, but in the band extracurricular, it might be that they entered more competitions, and so they had more entry fees and more buses, or they might have had more coaches for the band camps.
Those dollars come from the operating budget, if it goes above the band. Like that $10,000, where did that come from? Like, with there's a loss.
None of the ending. That's just the net gain or loss.
Okay.
The ending balance is going to be positive.
Still positive.
Yeah, Sharon, the town accountant and I won't let them go into a negative situation.
Okay.
So
you lost money. Okay.
No. It's just that's just the net gain or loss over the years period. So.
Okay.
And some of them, you know, the Parker, they spent a lot of money over the summer upgrading their performing arts center. So some of them, it's a timing difference. The next set is what I mentioned earlier, the donation accounts by school. Again, some of them, they may have been saving some of the donations to make a larger purchase and make an upgrade on something. As I mentioned, the Parker, they put in the monitors in their Performing Arts Center at Parker over the summer and upgraded the sound system, I believe. And then here are the ones that we take the offsets for. So a question came up about the athletics, and I'll talk a little bit about where we're at right now. The opening balance for this fiscal year that we're in is that ending balance as of June 30th, 2015. And as you can see, the athletic balance, it started at 175 and it ended at 112. We took an offset of $330,000. We only generated $311,000. That $311,000 is a combination of ticket sales, user fees, and donations. So it's not all user fee in that revenue number. And at last year's budget process, the school committee did vote to increase user fees, which did help increase our revenue this year. But we, again, in FY16, are budgeted to take more of an offset than what we're generating in revenue. So we're further eroding that ending balance, if you will. And so that was one of the questions that came from someone on the committee. Right now, the FY17 budget is projected to use an offset of $396,000, and that's to cover 100% of the coaches' stipends. So that was kind of our thought process on increasing that offset. And again, it was the thought of maintaining positions. Going down. The drama, we increased the drama offset for FY17 as well, again with the idea of covering the stipends.
I do have an anticipated FY16.
I can go to that one if you want. Okay. The drama stipend, is that help?
Oh, I'm a plant in the audience.
Okay, no, it's okay. I probably should move forward as I start to talk through them.
Got me a little nervous.
Yeah, so the athletics, the offset for the athletics is, as I said, $397,000. That covers the stipends for the coaches. The offset from the drama of $57,000 covers the drama stipends as well as some other ongoing expenses involved in the productions of the plays. The extended day, the $175,000 offset for extended day is a combination of a few things. It's the $90,000 offset that Dr. Doherty spoke about earlier, the increase to cover for facilities cleaning. It's also $50,000 for the rental of the space at the 5 elementary schools, and then there's another offset of $35,000 for the central office support to help run the program because we compile their payroll, we help them with their warrants, and there's other oversight between the assistant superintendent and myself. So there's a $35,000 offset. So those three combined for the $175,000 total that you see there. The expenses that you see there, the $1.2 million, that covers the cost of the program director. She has a site coordinator, a billing and payroll person that just started, a billing and collections person that just started, and another registrar who just started. It also covers all the people on the ground, boots on the ground at all five elementary schools. So her staffing really fluctuates based on enrollment. So she has staffing metrics that she uses. So once she gets to a certain level of enrollment, she has to add new staff. It also covers snacks at all five elementary schools for the kids who are involved in her program. And what are the other questions about that?
So this almost a combination, is it, when you talk about other expense, some expenses are charged directly to that program, and then you also have an offset to cover some overhead kind of things. Am I looking at that correctly? Or not, right?
A little bit.
The offsets go to the operating budget.
Yeah, right.
The other expenses are charged directly to that revolving
account. The revolving
account,
yeah. So where you see the other expenses, for example, in athletics, we receive donations for to assist in coaching positions or to purchase above and beyond equipment that wasn't in our operating budget. That's another expense that got charged directly to the revolving fund because the revenue came in for it. Same thing on the drama. The other expenses that are there are things along the line of the royalties for the plays, you know, Mary Poppins, the royalty for Mary Poppins around the world, Naming Days, things like that that we charge directly to the revolving fund.
Yeah.
Did that answer your question?
It did. That's
thank you.
So actually, I was the one who raised the question. Some of the things that are done here with the increased offsets are great for the year.
Mm-hmm.
But as we look forward, they're not sustainable. For example, athletic activities, you're going to have a balance of $7,500 roughly. So you wouldn't be able to take as high of an offset in the future. You're going to have to fold it some other
way. Yeah.
So that's, because it's not sustainable, that's going to put pressure on 18.
Correct.
Big time. Mm-hmm. And the athletic one is the one that stood out, but even look at use of school property, and that one could get into a trouble area.
Yep.
It could, and right now we have a coordinator, a facilitator, who, use of school property, administrator who oversees that, and he and I are working together on our rental fee schedule, because we haven't increased our rental fees in a number of years, so we're doing a little bit of due diligence in what his comparable communities are doing and what's appropriate to do here. So we'll have a recommendation and a presentation to the school committee probably sometime early spring.
Awesome.
Or in spring, but soon.
So,
Martha, I think you have a question.
Sorry.
I don't know if this is okay time to ask it, but is there a reason why the extended day has to maintain such a high end of year budget? Like, they have that much money, why are they charging us so much?
That is something that the town accountant and I looked at, because our auditors actually raised the question a year ago in our audit review. And we realized that while the program has grown, we didn't staff it adequately in terms of support for the director. And so we did just add two more full-time positions for billing and collections and coordinating enrollment and things along that line. She's also looking at reinvesting in the program and changing her offerings, which will, so I don't anticipate that balance to continue to grow. It will start to decline over time. And we've also increased the offsets that we're going to take at it to support some of the operating budget things. But that was, did that answer your question?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay.
Yeah. Just one question to follow up on the idea of the increasing the fees for the school. Have you thought about looking at increasing the fees you charge for extended day and the RISE program in terms of your rental? Is that a way of actually gaining back some of the money out of the projected balance?
Well, I'll talk about those separately. So for extended day, the town accountant and I did do a thoughtful analysis on what was appropriate to charge back based on our current rental fee schedule and the amount of space that they're using, and we looked at the number of hours, and so the $50,000 calculation that we came up with is appropriate based on what our rental schedule is if we charge someone else to come in and use the property. So we really can't in good conscience charge them more than what we would charge someone else coming in to use the space. So it's appropriate for extended day. Rise, we don't really charge Rise for space because we're required to provide some of those services
to
students.
So it really would be fee based in terms of really just the extended day charging.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Rise is our preschool program. We really charge, we offset about $330,000 to that revolving fund each year. The $10,000 are small nominal supplies and things along those lines that they buy, we charge directly to the revolving fund. The use of school property we touched upon a little bit. The $200,000 offset is now split between the school department budget and the core. When town meeting approved that change in how we account for things, Sharon and I, the town accountant and I, got together and we kind of went through what that money really should be used for and where it should go. So a portion of that has gone over to the town core. The $100,000 that you see in there, that is other expenses. That's really the custodial hours, which we recapture in our rental revenue. So if we're charging for a custodian, we're getting rental income for the custodian. The special education tuition one, that's one that Dr. Doherty spoke about earlier. That really fluctuates based on the number of students that come into our district from surrounding communities. So we have a number of great programs in district at our elementary and middle and high schools. And other districts like Malden and North Reading send their children here rather than send them to a collaborative or a private day. We charge less, and it's still a school environment for their students, and so it's beneficial. In this current year, we took a higher offset for two reasons. One, we needed to adjust the ending balance on that fund because it had been allowed to grow and it shouldn't have, and we had a circuit breaker issue where we had a $240,000 reduction in circuit breaker for the current fiscal year. And so we utilized that fund appropriately to help restore that. Going forward, we had anticipated offsetting about $200,000 a year, but given the situation that we were in for FY17, we increased it to $215,000. And so that's where you see the $215,000 offset for next year.
Could you just talk a little bit about the general philosophy that you and Sharon put together this year, reviewing the overall total balance and then kind of moving to look at the total levels as well?
Yeah. So the town accountant and I worked together over the summer to review really the funds that are up here on the board. We looked at extended day, Rise, special education, and full day kindergarten. Those are the larger funds that we focused on. And the first thing that we did was look to make sure, to try and identify what our problem was, because we were carrying forward more money each year. So if you go back to that previous slide, the balances, the ending balances were broken. Were we charging too much or were we not expensing enough? And we really found that we weren't charging too much, we just weren't expensing enough. And so when it came to full day kindergarten, the cost to run full-day kindergarten is about $960,000 for that extra half day for the students that are enrolled. But a portion of those students that are enrolled are on individual education plans, and that half day is, we have to give that to them. And so we can't take the full $960,000 because some of that should be on the operating budget. Same thing with special education tuition. We really looked at what are the resources that we have in these programs that these students are coming into, number of teachers, number of paras, and is it an appropriate amount of money? And then what if they didn't come here, where would they go? And where is it compared to what we wanted to charge? Because we don't want to be more than a collaborative option. So we'd like them to come here because it really is an offset to our budget. And it's also good for our students, too, to have more kids in the program, more robust. Same thing on the Rise and the extended day. Really was our thought process was to try and identify, was it a revenue or an expense issue, and then how do we fix it going forward? And one of the agreements that we came up with and the school committee, the presentation that we gave to the school committee, was really to take the budgeted offset. We had a few years where we didn't take the budgeted offset, which helps the fund. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, I think if you look at the balance year end 15 at 2.9 million, year end 16, 2.3 projected down to 1.8. So it's a half million per year roughly that is being utilized as an offset to bring it into a balance that we've worked with the town accountant on.
Yeah.
And to, partially, there were some questions brought up in the audit a year ago. And we brought it up to them, in fact, and said, what are the appropriate levels here? How should this work? And that's the activity you guys started.
And they really, there's really no guidance from DOR on what the appropriate balance is. DOR, everything DOR says is you can carry the balance forward as much as you want. So it doesn't say that you have to have a certain level, but I think our auditors are comfortable with a certain level. The school food service one is a good one because that one has a federal standard applied to it. You can't carry forward more than 3 months worth of operating expense. The auditors were, 3 to 6 months, 6 to 12 months, given what the fund is and how volatile it may be or how dependent on revenue it may be.
So speaking about the school lunch program, 3 months, is that something we should be looking at going forward for our revolving accounts, the offsets that we have each year?
We don't use any offset to the school lunch.
I'm not necessarily mean offset, okay. But I mean carry over the funds that carry over.
I think, Dr. Doherty and I talked about it. I was going to put together something for the school committee to consider on what they might want to have as guidelines for ending balances. Yeah.
Respect.
We appreciate the work there.
Oh, thank you.
A lot of work, and that really made it clear because I think you had questions or something.
Yeah, for a number of years, I think.
Yeah, I thought it was okay.
So, kind of putting a closure to the presentation, what the budget is not able to address, anything that's really a long-term improvement to our district. We've had several conversations over the last couple of years about tuition-free public kindergarten, restructuring elementary school schedule, providing more electives and opportunities for students around the STEM areas, the arts, health education, civics and global education. Our high school right now is working on several different options for restructuring their schedule and program and changing graduation requirements. So those are things that this budget does not address. Providing additional supports for students, both for tutoring and social-emotional for the general population, and space. So this budget does not address any of those areas. The next two slides show some of the areas that I was just talking about. We're about to start implementing a new science curriculum, and there is no instructional support to work with teachers on that. The program does come with some professional development, but having that coach come in and work with teachers like we do with literacy and math is something that's going to be needed as we move forward. The complete science curriculum implementation after the 150. I just want to talk a little bit about that. This is probably a good time to talk about the science. So the plan is a 3-year plan. Next year, if the funding is approved, the implementation will be in grades 3, 4, 5, and 6. The following year, it'll be K to 2 in grade 7. The following year after that will be 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. That'll put us in a position, they're also at the same time transitioning to the new standards, which is a 3-year transition. The new assessment that's going to assess the new standards will be in 3 years. So it's a 3-year plan to get us to the new state assessment, which is when they're going to start assessing the approved standards that were in January. We're anticipating it'll be about $150,000 each year for the 3 years. That's for the startup costs for the durable goods. There will be ongoing, like science is a very consumable heavy class, so there will be an additional operating cost from this point forward, like there is now. We do have operating costs for our science kits. which will be part of the per pupil expenditure moving forward that from each of the buildings. So you can see that there are, I won't go through each one, but there is teaching staff here, elementary health educators, middle school health educators, school adjustment counselors to address the social emotional needs at the elementary level and at the high school, at the middle school level. The academic supports I was talking about for students that are struggling. We don't have a lot of tutorial support. We have some at the elementary, we do not have it at any other level. Additional special education staff. Right now, a lot of our special education staff spend more time on paperwork than they do with kids because of the number of IEPs that we have for each student. Additional clerical staff. We only have one instructional technology specialist at the elementary level for five schools. We do not have a district-wide technology leadership position. I know I've said this for a long time, but a lot of the district-wide technology leadership falls on my shoulders. Right now, we are looking to try to change our student information management system without an increase to the budget. That requires a lot of man hours and working with other teachers, which is something that I'm coordinating because we don't have that leadership position. And then funding for a cycle of technology maintenance and replenishment. Which we want to keep that five-year cycle. We don't have a set cycle right now, but having a five-year cycle so that we can replace our technology on a regular basis. And I know a person asked a question about computers, and it's in the answer is in the questions. I can get to that in a second. So these are things, these are not nice to have. These are things that a lot of other school districts comparable to Reading have these positions, these programs available. In their budgets. The last piece I want to show you is, one of the things that we've tried to do to avoid personnel cuts up to this year is to do a balance of budget reductions that were non-personnel or maybe slight personnel cuts with offset increases. So what you see this slide captures is from FY13 to next year's proposed budget is the reduction, combination of reductions, personnel, non-personnel, and offset increases to get to the difference between what was needed, between the level service need and the revenues that were available. This is the backup information for what you saw in the previous slide. So, in the FY13 budget, you could see there was mostly increases in offsets. FY14, we made some reductions. 15 in personnel, we made a little bit more reductions. In 16, we again made some reductions in personnel, but the focus was more on non-personnel and increases in offsets. And then this year in FY17, you could see that the upper areas are personnel. We finally had to make personnel the majority of personnel cuts because we just no longer could, there were no other areas that we could reduce anymore. So then take a possible glimpse at FY18, and I know that the town manager has done this as well. So assuming that it's a 1% increase, which is the around the projected increase, and all of this is really a projection, it's a back of the envelope projection. It's not been a detailed analysis, but if you go with the assumption that the it's a level service increased budget, similar to what we've had the last few years with a 1% increase in the budget in expenses, we get about a $408,000 increase from the FY17 budget. And when you look at what the estimated operating expenses would be compared to what's available, this would be the projected shortfall for FY18 if there isn't some sort of additional revenue stream included in next year's budget. That's a certainly an estimate, but I think it just takes a glimpse into FY18 that what could possibly happen. And I know that you've already started having the conversations about override, and so I wanted to show this slide to give you that piece.
Sorry, quick question. How's 43 million calculated or estimated?
It's an assumption that we are having the same increases that we've been having over the last several years. Yeah.
John, I think, sorry, Mark, you should put the caveat on there that we're going into a collective bargaining agreement, and that's a real loose number, right?
Yeah, it's a straight projection, and I'm just taking what has been the average increase for all expenses, not just contractual, but all expenses, normal increases, what we've been looking at. I'm trying to give people a picture because I know questions are starting to get asked. So what does this look like? And I know that was one of the questions that we couldn't answer tonight, but.
Okay. So maybe before you roll in, and for the benefit of the folks in the room, at the selectmen's meeting last week, Bob did a really nice presentation showing what the financial picture may be looking like going forward. And so that 1% that John was showing up there is looking at contractual costs, potentially looking at costs that we don't have much control over, and indicating what might be left over for increases. And he had a great chart that showed that over the past 13 years, 14 years, left over at the town, that the increase in budgets has been roughly around 3%. 3.1 up to 3.7 perhaps. So the number, that 1% came up as a number that just was kind of a starting point to have a discussion, because it seems unlikely that given the current revenues of the town, we could support something much, much different from that. So that's where that 1% comes from, so everyone has it grounded. What I'd also suggest is that if you didn't have a chance to see that selectmen's meeting, especially the part of the presentation by Bob, certainly the entire selectmen's meeting, that's very instructive and helpful. And I think some of that was published also, was that?
Yeah, there's links on the home page on the town's website.
And that's it, just helpful information.
Are there links on the school website too to that our presentation?
We can.
So I think
at this point.
Right. I think it would be a good idea. I just have another. So can you go back one slide? I think it was
this one?
So
I did show this at the January school committee meeting that you voted on the budget.
Okay, so that's, I think the thing here is as you look at the line of the subtotal reductions, you know, I appreciate the way that you presented the data, the previous slide and this slide, but as you look at that subtotal reductions, so above that line is really all your personnel. And so if we're looking at 1.8 million in FY18, and we keep going to the bottom, but we just don't, there's just not that much more to give. Even if you were to assume you could get 650, right? Or you could get the same offset subtotal, that's gonna be 1.6.
No, the danger about increasing offsets is that stops your new base the following year. It's like free cash. In a way that if you're using $2 million in free cash in FY17,
right,
that's your starting point, or you have to make reductions in your budget. So it's the same with revolving accounts. If you have to start at that number.
Right.
Because if you go down, then you're cutting your...
I guess what I'm trying to say is the burden of a cut to the extent of 1.8 million is going
to
be on the top part of the budget.
Correct.
That's
right.
What I'm trying to say.
Correct. Yes.
Because we're already there. So this...
So just to conclude the recommended budget, it is a below-level service budget, which I've already talked about. It does align with the goals of the district. It keeps most class sizes within the recommended levels. It does provide, with the $150,000, for the science curriculum starting to move forward, and professional development for teachers during the different transitions with the different curriculum frameworks. It supports teachers and it minimizes impact on programs. When we were making the budget cuts, the personnel budget cuts, there's no personnel cut is a good personnel cut, but we tried to minimize the impact on students. That was our goal when we were looking at the budget cuts for personnel. So, you know, this budget does the best it can with those reductions. So that's pretty much it. I don't know if I hit all the questions. The answers are in that second document that was given to you.
So just to kind of quickly go through, the first question related to the $150,000 for the new science curriculum, so I think we've got that through.
Yep.
The second is, actually we didn't talk this one through, the computer equipment budget.
Yeah. So that's really, it really is a timing of purchases. We do replace equipment that might need it during the course of the year, but the April timeframe is when we start to really assess our needs. The building, it starts at the building base, assessing their needs, and the technology specialists work with them to develop a quote, and the purchases are done prior to June 30th. They arrive over the summer when the staff has the opportunity to re-image them and the deployment at the beginning of the school year. So it really is a timing difference.
The other thing, too, is it also depends on what breaks.
Yeah.
So a year ago, we had several smart board arms go at the same time. So this money was depleted earlier in the school year.
Yeah. The other thing too is if you were looking back at total spend in prior years, we do our best to capture the actual expense in the school. So the budget might be in this district-wide account, but when we actually spend the money on the computers that are going to go to Birch Meadow, we try to capture the expense in Birch Meadow. So you might look at it and say, well, you haven't spent this all along. We have, it's within the actual school budgets. And that's for our end of year reporting. We want to capture expenses where they belong.
Right. All right, question three related to the revolving funds, which I think can be answered. Yeah. Question four was a question that was looking to try to understand the cost of running school on a per student basis. And essentially, which do the response, but my interpretation of the response of the discussion was that each school is providing different services, doing a lot of different things, and it's not particularly meaningful measurement to look for.
In a lot of ways, you're comparing apples to oranges. So you're comparing, if you want to just look at the five elementary schools, because it'd be difficult even to compare elementary, middle, and middle to high. So if you want to look at the five elementary schools, each school, where 80% of your budget is staffing, now, if everyone was on this, made the same amount of money, that would be easy. But because you have different levels of seniority in each school, different schools are going to have more veteran staff, less veteran staff, which is going to affect the amount of personnel costs. You also have some schools that have more intense staff because of their special education programs over others. So, for example, the language learning disabled program, which is at Joshua Eaton, is less staff intensive than the Developmental Learning Center program at Birch Meadow, just because of the nature of the disability. It would be very difficult to do. You could do a per school calculation, but you
right.
to compare it wouldn't.
Right. Do you have another question? Okay. Question number five was the funds beyond just those in the general fund supporting the schools. And that was the chart that shows it's 46 million as compared to 40.7 that comes from the general fund. Question six was asking about revolving funds and balances. I think we talked those through.
Yep.
Are there further questions?
Seven is the computer question. So I had our network manager answer this question, and so I hope it makes sense to whoever answers it. the bottom line is old hardware doesn't necessarily help us. It actually is more labor intensive for the amount of staffing that we have. It actually would cost more money from a staffing perspective to maintain.
And then questions 8, 9, and 10 were kind of hypothetical ones related to if there's an override, which I'm sure that the school committee and the superintendent will be having discussions about in the future, but not this evening. Other questions from the finance committee? I'd like to talk about. No? Questions from the public? Folks that we diminished suddenly. School committee, any other questions? I think to me the question core question related to, as it relates to the budget and the upcoming town meeting, is the discussion of the $150,000 and bringing that into fiscal 16, so that you get the books in advance. And then what the number that we'll vote on next week will be the 40.6.
The town managers.
The town managers, right. And unless amendments are made, that's the number that we'll be voting on.
Well, we have an opportunity, so we'll have an opportunity to discuss both of those together, and so that we can, before we take any vote, we can sort of have a conversation ahead of time as FinCom as to how we're leaning.
Yes.
Okay, very good.
Yes, so.
Because one, the vote on one influences the vote on the other, certainly.
Mm-hmm. So that's a good question. So are we going to vote warrant articles next week as well? Is that it? Okay. So the answer to that could be
yes.
And the goal probably would be to not to lock the door and not let anybody else until we finish up this.
I just had a question for Dr. Dougherty. Did I hear this correctly? When you said the 150, whether it's FY16 or FY17, you said if it's FY16, we vote around June 30th.
Before June 30th.
Oh, before, okay. Because I was thinking, really, we're only talking about days. Okay, so much earlier than June 30th. So that's
yes.
As soon as it's allocated, you can place the vote.
Yes, we're going to be prepared to do it this year if town meeting votes favorably to do it this year.
Okay.
And your students will be assessed on it. And your parents will get those test results, and those will be published. So it isn't just here are the standards, and you should go teach them. It's here are the standards, you have to teach them, and your students, whether you buy a new curriculum or not, are going to be assessed on it. I think that's just a really very, very important point.
Okay.
No, there's a grade 5 test, a grade 8 test, and then eventually the high school test.
About three classes.
So I just wanted to kind of.
But the common is grade 5 and grade 8.
And well, grade 9, we do grade 9 because we do get the biology.
Okay, but all of those are will be the new standard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's K-12. I don't think it's pre-K-12. I think it's K-12.
Is it going to go beyond lower than fifth grade, or is it just going to stay at the grade level?
I wish I had that answer. I don't know.
But
you never
does,
know.
But if it does, then the curriculum is going to.
The curriculum is going to start at kindergarten, yes.
Okay, any other questions, comments? No, we're all set. We're not going to do this tonight, right? We're saving for next week. Okay. A motion to adjourn. Now I'll entertain it from the finance
committee. Motion to adjourn.
Do we have a second? All those in favor?